Well, the statistics around the coronavirus have been revised upwards. 250 more deaths have been recorded. Almost all of them are in Hubei province, where this outbreak began. And as you can see from this graphic, there's been a huge spike in the number of cases too. There are now more than 48,000 in Hubei. That's up 15,000. And the upward shift is in part because of a broader definition of the virus and how it's being diagnosed. Here's the World Health Organization on that.
Crucially, we understand that most of these cases relate to a period going back over days and weeks and are retrospectively reported as cases since sometimes back to the beginning of the outbreak itself.
Well, here are the number of cases in China going up and up. We're now close to 60,000. The death toll in China is over 1,350. But in reality, that figure is higher. Those who die at home are not being counted in official figures. And the BBC knows from having spoken to people in Wuhan, that's what people are choosing to do. Here's a quote from an article on the BBC News website. "We'd rather die at home than go to quarantine." And while this crisis is escalating, there's increasing pressure on the authorities. Two senior officials in Hubei have now been sacked. Let's get more on this from Stephen McDonnell in Beijing.
Now, as to whether or not the dismissal of those two senior Communist Party officials on this very day is a coincidence or not, I'm not sure, but it doesn't look good for them. I mean, the Hubei Party Secretary and the Party Secretary as well for Wuhan City have both been removed. But somebody had to take a fall for this. I mean, there's a lot of public anger. A lot could have been done to bring this under control before millions of people left Wuhan. And in fact, there's a lot of evidence showing that in those early days, they tried to stop information getting out.
And here's Celia Hatton on who could replace those officials.
The two new men in place in Hubei and in Wuhan are both loyalists to Xi Jinping, especially the man in charge of the province, Yingong. He comes from Shanghai. Now, he's a man known for tough security measures, but also last year he implemented a citywide recycling program in Shanghai. Now, I know that probably doesn't sound that impressive, but in a city of 23 million, almost overnight, to get all of those people to suddenly follow new rules, he managed to pull it off. That program is still in place, and it's being carried out across China. So here's a man who's known for security and implementing really big projects overnight.
Well, all those skills are going to be needed because scientists and officials are trying to work together to fashion an effective response. For more on that, this is David Heyman, who directed the WHO's response to the SARS virus in 2003.
We're all concerned about what we don't know. We know so far what's happening and what we can see, but what we don't know is the real potential of this virus, whether or not this eventually could become a disease endemic in humans like TB, influenza, or others, because influenza also comes from animals into humans, and it sometimes becomes a permanent resident.
Another important detail is that we know that this virus is not spreading particularly quickly outside of China. Here's David Heyman again.
Well, certainly it's spread throughout China. And China's making every effort they can in the way that they do best to stop the disease. What's important, though, is those 24 sites outside of China and also the cruise ships. That's where the information about how severe the disease is will really come from, because the patients here are being monitored very closely, as are their contacts. And we're learning a lot as we see what happens in these situations, which hopefully will lock down the disease in these countries and not permit it to spread further.
Well, let's shift our focus from China further south to Vietnam, because a town in the far north of Vietnam of about 10,000 people is now under quarantine following five cases of the virus. This is one image we have of the checkpoints that have been set up on the outskirts of the town. From Vietnam, we then shift to Cambodia, because that US cruise ship, which had been turned away by five countries, has finally been allowed to dock. Here it is. It spent 2 weeks at sea searching for somewhere to stop, despite the fact there are no confirmed cases on board. And here's an image that we saw online of passengers cheering and clinking glasses as they finally arrived in port. And, well, they might celebrate. But for the moment, they're still going to have to remain on board as a precautionary measure. Next, we have to talk about perhaps the cruise ship that's been getting the most attention, the Diamond Princess, currently stuck in Yokohama. In Japan, it has over 3,500 people on board and no one's getting off. That's because of all those people, at least 200 passengers and crew are infected. Rupert Wingfield-Hayes is just beside it.
So the number of infections on board the Diamond Princess behind me here in Yokohama has again jumped today. 44 new cases confirmed today. That followed 39 cases yesterday. And that brings the total number of infections from the ship to 218. And that means, as we know now, that this is now the single biggest outbreak of the COVID-19 virus anywhere outside mainland China. The Japanese government has made a small concession to the criticism that has been building of its the way that it's handling this outbreak. They've said that very elderly people over the age of 80 will be allowed to disembark if they have underlying health conditions or if they are in one of those inside cabins that don't have any outside windows or balconies. So expect to see that start happening maybe tonight or on Friday. But there are many questions that remain. First of all, obviously, is are infections still taking place? Is the virus still circulating around the ship? No one really knows. And the other big question is, why still has the Japanese government not managed to test all of the passengers and crew on board?
Now, 2 weeks ago, a group of British nationals were evacuated from Wuhan in China, and they've spent 2 weeks at a hospital in northwest England. Well, now all 83 of them have been released. You can see one of them celebrating there. They've all been given the all clear. Fiona Trott was there as they left.
Sort of strange 2 weeks it's been for them, evacuated from China, coming here to the Wirral, signing a form, agreeing to be quarantined, wondering, do I have the virus? And then getting used to the confinement itself. One man left here earlier shouting, I'm free. So there is relief here this afternoon. But also, what's very, very clear is that all of the 83 people here are very, very grateful to the NHS staff for the care they have received.
Well, the man celebrating his release here is Matt Raw, and he's been giving his reaction to the BBC.
It is lovely, absolutely lovely to be out, and I'll no doubt be going out for a pint a little bit later.
And, well, who would blame him? Not that Matt is complaining about his ordeal, I should say.
I would say that 99.9% of us, if not 100% of us, are really happy to have been here. We're very grateful to have been here. You know, the last thing that any one of us would have wanted is to have passed that virus on, if we were infected, to pass it on to somebody else. You know, you have to live with that. You know, if somebody does get sick from it and dies, we'd have to live with that for knowledge for the rest of our lives. And of course, you know, that's not who we are. Most of us travel a lot. We travel extensively, and you know, there are risks associated with that. So we do take ourselves seriously as expats, and of course we want to be as responsible as possible. And if that means staying in quarantine for a couple of weeks, so be it.